Good morning and thank you for inviting me here to have some introductory words. At first, I would like to ask you to help me because I, on the one hand, belong to the organizers of the European Network of Remembrance and Solidarity, and that's why I would say we made a mistake not to add to our names the country. Please, I did it for myself because it is good to recognize to each other where do you come from, because it could be interesting to get in talk and in touch to each other. That's why I would like to ask you to add to your badges your country. It would be helpful for networking, and this is the aim of this conference. So I start with that. And I would start with another point, which I didn't know before, with that question, war against Hungary. And I would, if you see to 1956, and I would like to ask myself, is it right? Was that a war against Hungary? I could transfer it to the question, what happened in 53? Were these Russian Soviet tanks in East Germany, were that a war against Germany? I doubt about both. What happened in Czechoslovakia in 68? Was that a war against Czechoslovakia? I doubt about that too. My view is about that, all these cases, and there are others too, these were risks for the communist power, wherever. It was not the question of the country, it was not the question in which country it happened. That was the risk of the communist and Soviet power in this part of the world and wherever it happened, including the Soviet Union itself, it was fought against. And so I think it is important, and I take it only as an example, that we look to that concrete event in a broadened and not only the own national way. If we are here from all over of Europe, and we use that anniversary to look back to 1956 and look to that, but we don't look to that as historians. The most of us are not historians. But we look to that as an event of the European history, of an important event, but not only of the history for historians. It is a history of our own experience in the communist world. Even not living in the communist world, it was a European event. What happened in 1956? And that's why I asked yesterday the question, what about the involvement of, for instance, other enthusiastic students from the West coming to Hungary and fighting with that people against that occupation powers? That happens, that happened, even it was only in a little way, but that made aware that what happened here in 1956 was even not only an Hungarian event. It was much more than that. And the question is, what is our own relation to that? In that time, 60 years ago, that created hope for many in the beginning. What started here? That there could be a change of communism. what does it mean in that one country is going a little bit different way inside of the communist world. In 56 I was too young. I was only 4 years old. But it was changed in the Czechoslovakia in 68. This was my personal experience when I was a young boy. And I can tell you exactly the place when I got the information of the invention of the Russian tanks in Soviet Union in the morning of this morning of August the 21st of August in 68. Because I lived in GDR, we were involved in our feeling. That was a question of hope. And what does it make if it happens in one country with the others? In which way the others are belonging to? So it was a question of hope, and then in the August it was a question of desperation. And so the question of involvement is, I think, very important, and that raises the question immediately, the question of solidarity. What can I do in supporting it if such happens in our neighborhood or wherever? And at the same time, very often, it is the experience of being helpless. Very often, we really can't do anything. If we look to that time, especially when that war, as you call it, was defeated. Thousands, you told it us yesterday, thousands left Hungary. I think 10,000 left Hungary, looking for ways to live in a free world. And it needed countries to take them. And so we have that questions, the questions of war. War creates refugees, and refugees are looking for places to live in a free world. Live where they can live, where they can be engaged in their political life. And we see with that refugee question, we are not only in past, we are just in our current world. I, for instance, was active during the last 15 years with Václav Havel, and we looked to Cuba. We all know Cuba is not the last, but it is changing a little bit, communist country, and asking them and looking that, what about that dissidents there? That what about the opposition? We looked how we can create a framework to support them, which is difficult. The most European countries are not really ready, or were not really ready, to help the dissidents, including we in Germany. We look usually with the governments. But the question is how we can support them. And then you remember some years ago when the political prisoners were released, there was at negotiations, and they were invited by Spain to come to Spain. And then we dealt with that question, in which way we can support them. And Spain, for instance, dealt with that release prisoners in that way that they said, we have and we are ready to give you asylum as refugees, but not give you the chance to be a political actor. If we see, and that's why I asked the question of exile yesterday, we know that many people in exile, immigrants from communist countries, became and continued to be active in a political way. The first publications about 56 were published abroad. I think you mentioned it was in London. What happened today with people to help them to be active in their democratic fight for their countries? And that's a question to us. Do we, for instance, support these refugees from other countries, flying war, flying dictatorships, to be active, to give them the chance to be citizens and fight for freedom. I think this is a very important question for us today. History is not the question just for past, it's the question and the challenge for us today. If you look to 1956, then I mentioned it before, we have that long line of 53 in Germany, East Germany, after that Czechoslovakia, then with Poland, Solidarność and others. But these are only the, I would say, the main chapter of resistance and opposition against communism. Let's look to that small chapters of that. It happened a lot, and in my view, we don't know enough about each other. We don't know about the networks behind. This, in my view, is a very important question, and we should create common efforts, common research in Europe for that, what I would call the heritage of freedom beyond the Iron Curtain in the communist time. There are many links, but there are some little events, and it is important to deal with that. It was not all the same. If we look back, for instance, the question of violence can be raised. And the question is, why? Are there reasons why, in the end, the non-violent opposition and resistance succeeded in the end of the 80s? There, in some countries, were a lot of discussions about the use of violence. And I think this is an interesting question. I know, for instance, that there was a long debate and discussion with Mazowiecki, who, in my view, is one of that persons in that heritage who was very aware about that question, in which way is it possible, and in which way we shouldn't make compromises. Usually, we like to be a fighter. We like whatever will be black and white, and this usually is not the case. What is the importance of compromises in the fight for democracy and freedom? I would call the succeeding revolution in 1989, I would call it a negotiated revolution. That doesn't sound so wonderful. It is better to have really a hero. But in this history, not the heroes succeeded in the end, but that people who were ready to make compromises, negotiations, not giving the chance for a bloodshed. I think this again is a question we should talk about. Opposition and resistance in all these decades against communism, it was really different. And we know, and if we see that, for instance, the first 20 years after the year of miracle, the time between 1990 and 2010, you can say with to the current days, but how many difficulties we had in Germany, but look to Poland, look to Hungary, look to other countries, Czechoslovakia, how to deal, for instance, with that event. I remember, no, we have time, it was told to me, I have another some minutes. Because we are not two speakers, we should be free in the beginning. That's why some thoughts in addition. My point is that if you look back, for instance, in Czechoslovakia, there were many people who said, oh, what does it mean about that 68 heritage? These only fought for socialism in a human face. But they fought for socialism. Are they really freedom fighters? Look to 56. That people, was Imonoc really a man of democracy and freedom? What he had in mind? What were his concrete aims? We would like to have freedom fighters as we all are feeling ourselves, that in the real case we would like to be freedom fighters. But history is usually much more differentiated. And that's why the question is, let's look carefully to the concrete events. Let's look what happened in concrete. And so I think it is important to understand that it wouldn't be a problem if we differentiate the chapters of history in black and white. Let's acknowledge that usually history is different, dimensions of gray. Of gray, and look back to that kind of history, and from that we can ask ourselves, and we can look and find for judgment how behave people in difficult times, what were they ready to do, which kind of risks were they ready to take over, and with which strategies they really thought or in the end succeeded to come to a success. This, in my view, it's very important to look in a very differentiated way. Another question is that I think that it would be important to look how we deal it afterwards. How we deal with our past after dictatorship. How we organize the dimensions of living together of different people with different behavior. If you look to different countries in that time after 1945, for instance, if I look to France, to take a Western country, how to look to France and how behaved the new re-established French state and the population with that people who called them collaborators. Which dimension and which measure of collaboration is allowed and which not? We know that collaboration, it was really humiliating behaviors in France, for instance, with women who had a relationship with Germans in France in the time of occupation and many other things. This is a question of a society, and it happened, that kind of collaboration happened not only in the Western part, it happened in the Eastern part of Europe, not only in the time of National Socialism, it happened in the time of communism too. And that's why I think that's a challenge, how to deal with the question of reconciliation. And I say it because a theologian should be interested in. I will really close my remarks with that question, why and which way we deal with that past. In which way, and we talked about education with past, I think it is important not that's my view. Not to find heroes in the history to follow them. In my view, is history a field of learning how behave people in difficult situations and what can we learn with that? In which way, where is the red line to make compromises in difficult situations that can be in the time of National Socialism, it could be in the time of communism, but it can be in the time, in the current time too. Where are you ready to follow the public line, or where is the red line to say, no, I don't accept, I take risks, and even I lose my job if it is not accepted, to go my own way. The question of this own consciousness, in my view, is the most important question dealing with past. Thank you very much.